Greetings and welcome to the Badger Cave's West Wing, where our stealthy polecats bring us the latest news to discuss slam-bam badger style. Join Mustelede Resistance as we discuss Emma Sulkowitz's award for courage in the face of the patriarchy, but how does feminist Camille Paglia feel about that? A carn artist where the cosplayer was made to cover up her cami costume. Are SJWs to blame? A Korean Overwatch champion who was accused of cheating because girls can't be that good? Is this proof of sexism in gaming culture? And lastly, we have an amazing story of a father and a son reunited thanks to footballers. But isn't lad culture toxic? Well, let's get on with the show. So, my name is Brian, and I'm joined by Mike, Scott, and Anna Cherry. Thanks, guys, for coming on.
Word.
Woohoo!
All right. So, and I will, I agree with that statement. I agree with the woohoo and the word. Yeah. All right. So, I guess first...
Beginning with the word.
The word.
To your mother. Oh, yeah, I went there.
Nerd to your mother.
I mean, what? And your dad.
I'm getting bullied, you guys. I'm supposed to play home gamer, girl.
Go back to your gamer.
Yeah. All right, so let's do the first story. What's this piano sound my computer's making? So first we'll start with something like the convention one. This past weekend, a convention titled CEO 2016 took place in Orlando, Florida. The purpose of the event was to host cosplayers as well as fighting game enthusiasts from around the globe. One particular cosplayer named Ashley, who goes by the moniker Queen Riot, decided to dress up as Camille from Street Fighter. Apparently, there were people who complained to the CEO staff that her suit was too revealing, even though her getup is not much different from others who cosplayed as Camille at the same event. For those of you who don't know Camille, she has a great big meaty ass and shows it off by wearing revealing green one piece. It's like a leotard. Whatever it was about her cosplay, the hotel management security told her that she had to cover up after multiple complaints. Apparently, this wasn't the fault of CEO staff, nor the event organizer Alex Jibaili. Rather, it was simply the fault of the complainers, and it was the ultimate decision of the hotel owners. While admittedly she wanted to blame this on somehow on social justice warrior, it seems to be a little bit more nuanced than that. Unlike a normal convention, this event took place in, like we said, a hotel. People are walking around with their families and children who might not think this attire is appropriate to wear. As well, most hotels have strict policies against wearing bathing suits or revealing clothing in the halls or lobby. If there were a normal convention, this would likely not have been an issue. However, the tournament shares halls with families who might be there on vacation and who don't want to have their children see a leotard being swallowed by butt meat.
Wow, that was subtle.
What was originally a story about social justice warriors being prudes has evolved into a story about misinformation. It is unfortunate how often this happens when it comes to the culture war, and we have to be more self-regulatory if we want to attain the moral and logical high ground. So, yeah, this is one of those stories that when it first came out, a lot of people were thinking, oh, social justice warriors, feminists did this or whatever. But as it turns out, it's probably not the case. In fact, it's highly likely not the case. It's just because it's a hotel and they have their rules and there are families there. And the person who complained was likely someone with a family, with children. This also happened to another cosplayer, I want to say earlier this year, who is known for dressing as Vampirella and also is a very meaty woman, like curvy and
voluptuous.
Voluptuous.
The word you're looking for.
She's voluptuous, not like a land whale. And
not like 10 pounds of shit in a 5 pound bag.
No, not like that.
Not like that. No.
So I guess the main reason why I brought this up as a story topic was one, for people to remain adamant. If they hear something that sounds like feminists may have been responsible, that doesn't necessarily mean that they are. And the second thing is, when it comes to knowing the difference between the two, think of it this way. If it is something that men would enjoy and women would also enjoy, then feminists likely will not get involved. But if it's something that men would enjoy but feminists can figure out a way in which the woman is the victim, then they will. So this is more, probably more the former than the latter. Because, you know, just because of the time and the location. So, Anna, you have a story about butt cover-ups. That's great. We can talk about butts.
I was going to change my avatar to what I use on my Twitter right now, but then I realized we're talking about cosplay, so I didn't. And yeah, as you guys can see, I cosplay. And let's stop moving around my mic now. Here we go. So I do have stories. And I will say, okay, first of all, the curious thing about the whole thing that you're talking about right now, and I do really appreciate keeping us honest and keeping our side of the debate honest and making sure that we're not just jumping on the bandwagon and saying that, oh, our enemy did this. So I really, really appreciate that, Brian. That was a really good approach. And it needs to be said. But on the other hand, I do feel like the convention did mismanage some aspects of the situation because it came across my attention a few days before you posted it in Skype, and it was through Mark Kern's Twitter profile where he mentioned that he tweeted at this convention to find out, you know, why was a Cammy cosplayer banned, and he got blocked by them. No explanation, no reason to get blocked, and they just went ahead and did it. So that is kind of annoying and awful. Why would they do that? So moving on to the topic of actual conventions and hotels and butts. So most of the cons that I've gone to have been at hotels. I think only like Comic-Con, and I actually don't know. I've never been to Comic-Con, but every time I've gone to a convention, even at, like, Fanime is the only one that actually has bulk of its actions and panels in a convention center. But for the most part, it also has other hotels, like for Clockwork Alchemy and things like that. But other things I've been to, like Dragon Con and Mid-South Con and Sacramento, Sac Anime, just to name a few, actually, Calgary Expo was the only other one that wasn't a big venue. But for the most part, my point is, when I go to conventions, it is at hotels. So that is something to keep in mind when talking about this. And I have had an experience where I was wearing a succubus costume, my own version of what I am as a succubus, and I wore boy shorts. So they were obviously skin tight, and actually, it was bikini bottoms. Either way, it was butt was covered. It wasn't a thong-type leotard situation. And this was a Mid-South Con where we've been to before, but this year, the last year before I left the Mid-South, they were like, hey, how about you cover up until 10 p.m. because there's children here? Because we've had complaints. That was the first time that's ever happened, and I was very annoyed. And my point that I always try to make whenever told about covering up, and as you were saying, Brian, you know, children, hotels have policies. Look, what we wear is no less than a bikini at a pool. Hotels have pools. Yeah. You can walk to the pool in your bikini. Why the fuck is this? And so I tried to reason with them. I'm like, look, guys, it's not even a thong. It's like literally a bikini bottom. That's what this underwear is called, a bikini bottom. People, come on. And they were like, no, sorry, I complained to some other something. And I was very frustrated, and I didn't blame SJWs, of course. I blamed the regressive Southern religious puritanical culture, which is usually the cause for this, because someone's husband or son looked after a cosplayer, and this woman or the husband of this woman who knows what he's supposed to do goes, oh, this cannot stand. This is not allowed. But it's usually women that I've seen complain. Because men, in my experience, unless something is egregious, they will just kind of... men generally want to maintain peace unless it's something that absolutely needs to be done. But from what I've seen, it's usually women who try to meddle with little things and they try to kind of be a little more controlling of really tiny things. But it's just my experience. I could be wrong. But
I wonder if sometimes when adults make a big stink out of typically it's women, in revealing clothes, in front of children. I wonder if they don't, in many ways, sort of almost show the children that there's something, like, something edgy or you know, rebellious, or something's going on. For example, I don't know of too many children who saw The Little Mermaid and thought, oh my God, that's a naked woman in a bra. Like, this, right. Just wearing a bra. Like, no, I don't think that children noticed that. I think they were just like, oh, it's a mermaid, and there's music, and there's singing, and there's some laughter. And adults were looking at it, and they're probably thinking, wow, that's kind of sexualized, you know?
Yeah, children accept things as they are, and they're like, that's actually one of the reasons, the whole Michael Jackson information just broke recently, and that's actually one of the ways you desensitize children to violence and extreme pornography is by showing it to them, because they're like, oh, that's what humans do? Okay. Because, I mean, as primates, that's what we do. We observe the humans around us to learn what to do. That's actually why I feel like television and inappropriate representations of things on TV is damaging to younger children, because that's how kids learn, and a lot of times we don't have large communities of real people hanging out with each other. So you have children watching things and hearing their parental opinion only, and they get this idea that whatever their parents believe and whatever TV says is reality. That's how primates learn. But I feel like you're right, and not only does it bring it into their awareness, whereas before they had absolutely no knowledge of it being naughty because their brains don't think about sex the same way as adults do. So not only does it do that, but I think for other children, it shows them the power you can have over someone when you complain. And I think that is also very dangerous in its own way.
Well, and it's teaching the children to be ashamed of themselves, too. I mean, if you want to look at it in a much broader context.
And I don't think it actually is about the kids at all. I think that's an excuse.
Well, absolutely. They're using them as a shield. Absolutely.
Well, back to actually my story, the other side of the whole butt debacle was that at a different convention, I was wearing a Major Kusanagi outfit, and I had a hard drive crash, so I can't show you that particular cosplay, and it has been stolen in a car break-in, so I literally don't have it.
I remember it.
Yes, the butt was, it was swallowed by butt meat, absolutely. Yeah. And I went to C2E2 in your Chicago, Brian, and I was walking, and C2E2 had toddlers and fucking strollers, and I have never seen strollers at all in that amount, or almost at all, at conventions and dealers rooms. It's not something I'm used to in the Mid-South, and when I went to C2E2, I was like, oh my God, there's so many kids here, I'm so gonna be told to fuck off. This is horrible. Nobody said a word. Not a word. I was walking around in an extremely revealing thong, basically, outfit that is a lot like this cami, where the front was, you know, narrow, and the back was narrow, and I was walking around, and people took photos with me, and nobody said a word. Thing is, that was at a convention center. I think it was the Rose Bowl or whatever, Rose something, and it was great. It was fine. So it could be just that it's a hotel thing and people know that they can, manipulate hotel staff. And it's a very good point that it could just be randos who have nothing to do with the convention. Because that's one of the things that's kind of used to weird me out. When going to conventions at hotels, you will have people that are there for, like, some business convention even, or just regular people, you know, living, or, like, there's a wedding. It's like, it gets awkward because they look at us like we're freaks, and we're looking at them like, why are you judging me? So, I don't know. It's a bit of a mess. So, I think it is a complex issue, and the fact that it's a hotel is probably the likeliest culprit, because I was told to cover up in a hotel and not at a convention center. But I also think that local moors might have something to do with it as well.
Yeah. And again, you know, it's worth pointing out, because it is very easy for us to jump to the conclusion that feminists are responsible. It's impossible to know, because the same thing happened to another cosplayer. I'm going to show you a video. I won't have any sound, though. And she was a Vampirella cosplayer. And obviously, her outfit was also almost non-existent. But she played it's accurate, you know. Yep. And,
here's another thing to think about, too, just real quick, is I wonder how long this convention has been going on at this particular establishment, because you know, if you're talking about places like Dragon Con, which have been around for, well, decades at this point, you're talking about there's a culture that has been built there, and they kind of understand the dynamics of cosplay and all these kind of things because they've had to deal with it. So I wonder if this might also be an issue of this is a new convention. Because this is, not that I've ever heard of all the conventions ever, but this is one I'm not familiar with. So it's kind of like, you know, I'm wondering that there's other things at play here, and it's not just a very simple, clear-cut, you know, matter of you know, SJWs or whatever.
Actually,
you know, so.
Yeah, I think there is possibly something to it, because I'm just looking at this video, and the other photo of the Kami cosplay they showed, both of them feature these women, especially Vera. She is doing, which is the word faith in Russian, by the way, just so you guys know. Vera. Is doing very much trade, and she's an adult performer like myself, as well as a cosplayer. So right. She does very adult trade show activity. Like, as you saw how close she was to that man in that photo, that's very typical for what adult trade show stars do. You cozy up with a fan, you take a photo, and that's, I mean, at trade shows they go even further than that, but, you know, it's all for fun. And I usually don't see stuff like that at conventions anymore, since the whole cosplay is not consent thing. So in both cases, you have these women taking photos with men, and in my experience, men have stopped coming up and asking for photos. So it's possible that they are restarting again because, you know, of us pushing back to the whole cosplay is not consent idea and talking about me personally and others, talking about really liking for people to take photos with you, and that's like the whole big part of it. And so I think maybe you guys are like, oh, I guess it's okay now. You know, maybe we should go up to them and ask, you know, to do the normal photo thing. And it's possible that that is what triggered someone, that it was the fact that, you know, as you said, if women are enjoying it, it's fine. And that's true. Feminists are all for female cosplay. In fact, I was, I don't know if you guys read my, what it's like to be a non-feminist sex worker on the internet, but I got denied access to basically a career in cosplay with Geek Goddess, because they say they are a feminist company and they don't think they're going to work mesh well with who I am. And they're not the only ones, of course, but Cosplay Deviants also, of course, fired me.
Really?
Oh, yeah, they terminated my contract as a model because God's Girls. Yeah, because God's Girls unreasonably let me go from their purgatory page because I tweeted something about believing all women, meaning that the man is guilty and can never be proven innocent in the court of public opinion. And they thought I was talking about James Dean directly, and they were like, oh, we will never, you make us feel unsafe, go away. And
well, let's be honest, God's Girls is kind of terrible anyway, so.
Right, but I wanted to network with the girls that are there. To be honest, I literally wanted to take their girls and do work with them, the ones that I wanted.
Right, yeah.
And so you guys can read my thing, but it was basically like I waited for them to be reasonable. They said, fuck off. And then I talked about it on Twitter, and a few days later I asked Cosplay Deviants about the sets that they were keeping in a limbo for like 8 months, which is just fucking ridiculous. And they're like, oh yeah, you're fired for no explanation, bye. With no explanation, and that's it. And then, so I'm, you know, obviously they are feminist in a way. And then Geek Goddess specifically told me, like, no, we're feminist, and they were very nice. They're like, look, you know, I appreciate you and all that, but, like, you're not feminist, and we are, so we're not going to be a good fit, etc. Therefore, we have so many companies that have naked cosplayers who are feminist. So feminists don't really care that much about women showing their bodies as long as it's the female choice, especially nerdy girls. So that's great. However, as we were saying, whenever there's something that could harm women or something that only men are enjoying, seemingly, that's when the feminists really come out and speak out against it. So, I mean, this is my just tinfoil fedora, but, you know, it's possible that they were like, oh, those girls are taking pictures with too many guys. I don't like that. They're being taken advantage of, or, you know, my husband's staring at it too much, or whatever the fuck. I don't know.
Mm-hmm.
Or I could never look like that, and I know she shouldn't be allowed to either. Whatever the fuck it was. And, yeah, anyway, so that's kind of my...
I've actually heard people at conventions say that. I've actually heard people say that, like, legitimately.
Oh, and I thought I was being hyperbolic.
No, I heard two girls talking, and they were just being catty as fuck. like, oh my God, why is she wearing that? She shouldn't wear that in public. I would never wear that. I can't wear that. Oh God, I bet, you know, there's just like, what? I was like, this is like the kind of conversation you would like see in a movie like Mean Girls or something. Mm-hmm. You didn't actually think people actually spoke like that. And I was like, holy fucking crap, this is so dumb.
You can't sit with us.
Well, I think women have a hard time with individuality. I think there's a lot of well, because of the tendency to cooperate, that also means, I mean, there's two sides to everything. There's lightness to every darkness, and vice versa. So in order to be able to cooperate, you also need to be able to be more hive-minded. And in order to be able to lead, you have to be more individualistic. So men have, you know, of course, the whole lad culture and toxic masculinity is basically just leadership qualities that have a dark side, because that's how it is. Well, women and feminism is the dark side of the community building that women do. So I feel like that's kind of part of it, that women have a hard time understanding individuality in the same level that, you know, perhaps more Aspie people or men do. Because they're like, oh, well, I don't like it, therefore she doesn't. Or I don't like it, so, you know, me is her is me, this kind of thing. And it's like, right. No, that's a separate person. Just because you wouldn't wear that doesn't mean that she's having the exact same feelings on the inside that you are. You know, so, yeah, those are my two cents.
So this image, just as the last image, this is basically what she had to wear for the remainder of her time at the hotel, according to her, which, you know, it kind of ruins the whole costume. But it's impossible to know, again, you know, whether or not what the source of it is. And I would ask that, you know, if you guys see stuff that sounds like social justice warrior talk, maybe, you know, just sort of like think about it more. And see if it really could be coming from the other side or from a place that could potentially even be reasonable. But because it's hard to tell sometimes, I think that that says a great deal about social justice warriors. So because you can't really tell them too much, you know, sometimes you can't tell them apart from, like, the religious right, for example, I think that that really says a lot about, you know, where they're coming from, so... Cammie, I hope that you, in the future, will, you know, allow your butt out because it should be tanned in the light, so.
You don't like pale girls? Why are you pale shame here, huh?
No, I mean, I like a little bit of, you know, a little bit of tone differentiation, a little bit
but
of...
But she's being like accurate cosplay. Cammie's pretty white, isn't she?
Huh?
Yeah, she is.
Yeah, Cammie's pretty white. I mean, it's. I think she's just being accurate to the to the Aryan that Cammie is.
Yeah. No, well, no, she's British, so...
Queenie Wright is totally
Aryans in Britain.
She's British, so yeah, she should be pasty as fuck.
Yeah, there you go.
Exactly.
No, it's not pasty, it's alabaster, Brian. Stop shaming. Alabaster. Stop shaming, Brian.
It's gray.
All the shaming
time. It's marble. Translucent marble.
Hey, amen. Leave Queenie alone. She's a beautiful lady. In all her pastiness.
She's good. I'm fine with that.
I've been a fan for years.
I'm not really complaining. at all. But anyway, yeah. So that was our first small story. So let me move on to the next thing here. La 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 la. All right. Lesson number one. Don't fuck with Camille Paglia. The National Organization for Women has just awarded their Woman of Courage Award for the year. This award is often given to women for, quote, having demonstrated personal bravery in challenging entrenched power and in carrying out action that has the potential to benefit women in general. People achieving great things against impossible odds should be a feat that is recognized more so by our social organizations. I think we all agree. So who was this award given to? Turn down your volume and make sure to put a pillow in your desk. Mattress girl, Emma Solsowitz. Yeah.
Let's give a big round of applause for
Emma Solsowitz. Stunning and brave. Stunning and brave.
Stunning and brave, yes.
Those groans you just heard should say all you need to hear about why she is so undeserving of this award. After the reenactment of her rape via sex tape, as well as the admission that carrying around her mattress was an art project for which she received school credit, plus an incident with an art gallery, it seems that she is one of the least likely candidates for advancing the well-being of women anywhere. But this isn't the most appalling news that came out of this event. Oh no. In fact, Mattress Girl took to her Instagram account and posted a picture of herself with the award. In the description of her photo, she decides to take a shot at resident feminist badass and beloved based goddess Camille Paglia. Quote, this is what Emma Sulkowitz wrote. Quote, Camille Paglia has publicly called my artwork a masochistic exercise in which I neither evolve nor move on. She speaks as if she, a white woman, knew what was best for me, a woman of color she never met. Once again, her crowd decides to make it about race when rape is something that affects all women. But anyways, the quote goes on. Quote, many people ask me how I've healed from my assault, as if healing were another word for forgetting about it, getting over it, or even shutting up about it. To expect me to move on is to equate courage with self-censorship. The phrases suck it up, move on, and get over it are violence. People who say that these phrases equate what is right with what is expected. I think courage means afraid in a way that makes you do what is right, even if it's unexpected. Courage is fear. Up is down. Okay. I gotta read that again. The phrase, suck it up, move on, and get over it, those are violence. People who say these phrases equate what is right with what is expected. I think... Courage means afraid in a way that makes you do what is right, even if it's unexpected. I dedicate this award to everyone who has not told me to get over it. Thank you for validating my fear and my way of handling it. Thank you for creating a world in which...
Thank you for validating my fear.
Yes.
The six words that make up feminism. I mean, that's the Feminist Manifesto, isn't it?
Yes.
I'm validating my fear. Who says that? Who says that and thinks it's a... Oh, I can't.
Well, apparently somebody that makes a sex tape after being raped.
Not raped.
Well, oh, sorry.
I mean, she was raped in such a way that it was a good rape. Good enough that she was asking for butt sex, like, right afterwards.
Saying, right?
So, forgive me for not wanting to smell your bullshit.
Yeah.
All right, so thank you for validating my fear and my way of handling it. Thank you.
When I think there's women out there like Erin Pitsey, yeah, and there's women in armies out there going out and fighting fucking ideological theocracies, and in the meantime, who's getting a fucking award for fighting against entrenched fucking systems?
Oh, even more than that, there's actually a model who quit being a model in Canada or Australia or somewhere and went to fight ISIS. Straight up, where's her freaking award?
Fuck but yeah.
I do want to say that one little thing. I think I know what she was trying to do, that whole Green Lantern movie thing, which I actually really enjoyed, unpopular opinion. But she tried to do the whole, like, she misspoke, but I think I know where she was trying to come from, which is, courage doesn't mean not being afraid. Courage means you are afraid, but you still push through it to do the right thing. Yes, I completely agree with that. But it's a baby, it's a tiny midget baby in an ocean of bathwater. And it's just really frustrating to me as a woman who refuses to be a victim, even when I have been wronged. There's so much dirt I could... There's so many tears and whatever's I can cry about all this fucking bullshit that has gone on that's been done to me based on my ideological beliefs. But I won't, because there's no point in that, and I refuse to be a victim. I choose to move on in a healthy and constructive manner. And that is what you're supposed to do to have appropriate mental health. But apparently, according to this girl, that appropriate mental health is violence. So, my head is full of fuck. I can't.
Mm-hmm.
I'm just sad that this is reality, because it's, once again, teaching young girls to be like, I mean, I realize, like, if something horrible happens to me, I can turn that around and make it good. That's beautiful, I suppose. Thing is, she's not actually advocating any kind of mental health improvement or in any way actively doing something about it. And I don't have words to express how bullshit this whole situation is of her making the tape in the first place.
I wonder if Emma Sulkowitz started digging this hole of manipulation, misinformation, and straight up dishonesty, right? And it's one of those things where a kid tells a lie so that he can get something. And then as people start to just take the lie apart, he lies more and more to like keep the illusion alive, because essentially the danger of getting caught in a lie overrides the ability to simply confess and say, you know what, I was lying about everything. Like because they were so convinced that it was going to work, and as it sort of snowballs forward, you know, and then she gets an award, and now she's like, holy shit, I really got to keep this bullshit going. Well, like, I can't confess now. I got an award, and I went up and walked and got my degree carrying the fucking mattress. I passed the class with it. My life is a lie, and I have to keep it alive. And now I have to defend my position. So how do I do that? You know, well, I guess I'll wallow in my fear and wear it like a badge of honor.
Well, it's curious that you say that, because you didn't quite take that thought where I thought you would, based on what I was thinking, but it's part of the same kind of the same vein of thought, which is, as soon as you read, thank you for validating my fear, I instantly thought, oh, she's really happy that nobody caught on to her lie and that they actually allowed her. Something about that expression, the fear of being caught, is what got sort of removed by her getting this award. I don't know, it was just this weird fuzzy feeling I got about her actually being happy and feeling validated that nobody's going to call her on anything. It's like, over, she won, the lie passed the test. It's all good now, and I think that's where her thankfulness was coming from. But you know, it could just be me, you know, reading.
Have you guys ever known someone who has lied so much that they actually start to believe their own lies?
Pathological liars do. Yeah, I've never met one, but I've read and learned about them.
I actually know. I used to be really good friends with a kid that was like that. He just was constantly making shit up, and it was like. And it was so weird, because it was stuff that just, like, we knew his family, and it was stuff that just could not be true.
Oh, yeah.
But he just kept going with it, though. It's just like, and I was like, I didn't know if it was, like, a matter of him being, like, insecure and just trying to, you know, feel better about himself or something, or if he was a pathological liar. But as years went on, though, it became pretty obvious that he couldn't fucking help it. I mean, it was just like every other word out of his mouth was just total fucking bullshit. So
for every one of those kids that grows up to be a pathological liar, there's another 9 that just grow up to be deluded. Much like Emma Sulkowicz. I imagine so many people she passed with her mattress was so tempted just to go up to, just give me that mattress, darling. Give me that. Give me that. Okay. You're an idiot. You're an attention seeker. Nobody cares about your sex life. Stop it. Stop it. Go home. But nobody did. No one actually went through with it, because they knew that it wouldn't work. They would look like an asshole. Because
she would accuse them of stepping off
this. She's gone her whole fucking life doing this, and no one's ever had that talk with her. Yeah.
Well, that's a problem, though, because they'd accuse her, or she'd accuse them of assault, though, and then she'd have another
victim
thing.
Blaming.
Yeah. She'd have another reason to fucking be cry-hole about it.
Yeah,
oh, no, they attacked me!
That's the thing about people who don't use logic and just to basically rely on emotion as their way of understanding the world. That's why they end up being, you know, capable of being pathological liars. And that's how that happens, because the first person you have to convince is yourself in order to be able to lie. You lie to yourself first, and then you lie to others. And that's where we go from delusion, which is lying to yourself, to being so fucking good at believing your own lies that you're a pathological liar to others. So it is essential to lie to yourself in order to be able to lie to others well.
Yeah, I knew a guy who I went to high school with, and this was what Mike is saying. This actually happened. And he used to lie about where he was from, his experiences, things he's done. And it was all so dramatic and so overblown. You know, it was one of those things where everyone knew he was lying because it was so exaggerated, and his life was as boring as the rest of us. But he, for some reason, he was really believing his own bullshit. And then one of my friends one day just snapped and said, would you stop lying to us about your life? Nobody cares. You know, we don't care. Like, just, you know, it's fine. Just stop lying to us. It's insulting. And he broke down. I mean, the guy had a fucking psychotic break, and he had to go into a hospital. Like, the being faced with the reality that all of the bullshit that he constructed, nobody in his life actually believed. And actually, did it backlashed on him. He had to go into therapy. I haven't seen the guy since. I think he was living in the YMCA last time I saw him. That's what I got.
It's really interesting that you bring that up, actually, because, okay, sharing time. I grew up in a way that I had extremely low self-esteem, and I thought my life was boring and horrible, and I lied to people about life events. And thing is, though, I actually remember, we did know a pathological liar. I completely forgot about that guy. But so I have a story time a little bit. So I told lies about life events, like, oh, I lost my virginity at 14, or I don't know, whatever the fuck, which I didn't until 16, and like, I lied to my friends about that, and I lied about, like, some boyfriend who, like, fell out of a plane base jumping something and died. I don't fucking know. There was, like, three big stories in my life that I told people, and I knew there were lies. I knew 100%. So it's always really weird to me to meet pathological liars and be like, how do you not know that you're lying? Thing is, though, I was really bad at lying. My theory of mind was shit. So I had no idea. I was a really bad liar. I was a really bad liar because I wasn't convincing myself well enough. I knew that they were lies, and so there were obviously irregularities and inconsistencies, and people could pick up on it. And I finally, you know, when I met my partner, he was like, hey, by the way, you know, we should talk about this lying thing, and this is like your chance to come clean or basically fuck off. This was really early in our relationship, and I was like, you know what? Yeah, I'm going to come clean, because I always wanted to be seen for who I am and not for this fake shit. And he provided me with an environment where I could feel loved for myself, for being myself, and who I was, and my experiences were validated as interesting enough that I could let go of that need to be more interesting to people. And, you know, a lot of it came from being very lonely as a kid and ostracized and just weird aspy girl that I was. But on the other hand, I did meet someone in Memphis who was a pathological liar to the point, and it was so obvious, it, like what you guys were saying, like super exaggerated, like, a perfect example, he was talking about how him and his friends were walking around and they found an abandoned tank. And his friend, who's a math whiz, he, like, totally reprogrammed it so that they were able to put a paintball thing in it and then shoot it, like, 2 miles at his other friend. And then he, like, called his friend on the phone and was like, hey, dude, look up. And he was, like, standing at a cross road. And his dude, like, looked up and got hit with a paintball. Whoa, from that tank. It's so crazy. And we're like, Logan, God, dude, come on, what? Just no, what? Mm-hmm. And we talked to him. We're like, look, Daddy took him aside, and he was like, one night, and he was like, all right, we got to talk about this. So I don't actually know exactly everything that they talked about, because, you know, it was kind of a private conversation that, you know, I chose not to. You know, it's one of those things where you feel like you're paraded in front of a group and you're being made fun of, versus when one person talks to you one-on-one, it's a little different. So they were doing that, and they basically told him, hey, you know, we know. It's pretty obvious. There's really no need for you to do that. We like you. You're our friend. Let's just drop it. And he couldn't. He was one of those people, unlike me, who knew that they were lying. And when given a chance to actually let go and be forgiven and show who you are, he couldn't, because he was just too far gone. And it was the other type of people who just lie to themselves and become, who are pathological liars. So I think there is a difference between those who lie to get attention and they know that they're lying, versus those who start believing their own lies and eventually become completely pathological, or from the very beginning have a very tenuous grasp on reality and just become pathological liars. So, that's my story.
All right. Hannah, thanks for joining us. Sorry if you got this later. We're having any issues.
You're having issues too.
I did, like, in the beginning, but it seems fine now. Knock on whatever this is. Yeah. I don't know.
I didn't get here late because of that. I got here late because I had to get on the phone actually with Expedia and fix a problem that the airline caused with my flight to the London. The London ICMI. Convention, you know, the ICMI, and I just, you know, to be honest,
I was afraid they weren't going to be able to fix it because it was such a bizarre and complex issue. And the Expedia staff was absolutely stellar, and they fixed my problem. And I told them I couldn't afford a bunch of fees for changing and everything, and they fixed it, and I didn't owe a bunch of fees, so I'm really happy right now.
Nice. Sweet. That's great. So we were just talking about Emma Sulkowitz getting the Superwoman of Courage Award for the year.
There goes the happy.
Did you not know about that?
I saw a little thing about that. That's insane. How can they give her an award when everybody knows that she lied?
but listen and believe. Yeah. I don't know. Rape so nice, she had to do it twice.
You can't deny her lived experience, Hannah.
Yes. Yes, I can, because it wasn't her lived experience. It was her.
I think they're seeing her as a role model for actual rape victims, because they're really not getting it.
That's so deeply insulting. It's deeply insulting on a rapacious level.
No, you're right. I mean, it is really messed up. So I want to read this last bit, Hannah, for you that Emma Sulkowitz wrote, because I didn't quite finish her statement. But I'll start over so Hannah can hear it. Many people ask me how I've healed from my assault, as if healing were another word for forgetting about it, getting over it, or even shutting up about it. To expect me to move on is to equate courage with self-censorship. The phrases, suck it up, move on, and get over it, are violence. People who say these phrases equate what is right with what is expected. I think courage means afraid in a way that makes you do what is right, even if it's unexpected. I dedicate this award to everyone who has not told me to get over it. Thank you for validating my fear and my way of handling it. Thank you for creating a world in which we can tackle the things that terrify us by doing the unexpected right thing. Thank you. That was her thing that she wrote.
So basically, when something terrible happens to you, you should be crippled for life and never, ever be able to get out from under the pain and suffering of that. Are you serious? Because, like, I got to go back to high school if that's going to be the case.
Finally, Hannah, you understand. It's taken you so many years, but you finally made it.
I'm not sure I can even get back to the place where I was when I was hurt.
Strength is weakness.
Yeah.
I mean, like, you... Does she not realize that throughout the history of the world, the reason society has been able to survive and progress has been that human beings have picked themselves up from terrible things and moved on? Even if it still hurts sometimes, even if it still hurts all the time, and even if it still hurts a lot.
Amen.
A wolf among bunnies is the bravest bunny. Wait, no, that's backwards. Forget it. It's backwards, therefore it's right. The panelists, okay, let me finish the rest of this. The panelists will respond to this bag of lies in a second. To conclude, I want to include this quote from a woman named Alexandra Villarreal, who goes to Mattress Girls University. She wrote a piece for HeatStreet.com commenting on the, quote, damage done by Mattress Girl. The article is a worthwhile read as she presents a very balanced point of view, incorporating arguments from both sides of the debate. But for now, I will end by focusing on one particular message, quote, competing tensions that make men feel endangered and women silenced have created a climate that has actually quieted discourse about how to improve sexual assault prevention and enforced antagonisms that perpetuate gender-based misconduct instead of prohibiting it. Men are scared of women on campus now, and fear breeds anger and prejudice. Women are frustrated by men, which inspires a lack of desire to collaborate for solutions. Okay, that's the quote that she wrote. I will add an addendum to that. Men are scared of women on campus now because of the policies and the climate that was created by feminist ideology. Of course they are, and they should be. You guys that are going to college, you should be afraid, because that system can fuck you over even if you aren't hanging out with a girl, even if you didn't touch her, you can just get screwed by that system. I can understand that. I don't think it breeds anger and prejudice, though. I mean, at least not anger and prejudice towards women. Perhaps towards the system itself.
If you're going to submit yourself to mob rule, it had better be for a really fucking good education. Mm-hmm. No, don't submit yourself to that for some bullshit liberal arts degree. So not worth it. Wait until it's blown over.
Hannah, you want to go ahead and throw that in there?
Yeah, I'd add also that sexual misconduct is not gendered. It's not gender-based. It happens to both sexes, and it happens at the hands of both sexes. Gender doesn't enter into it at all. But a person can be forgiven for not being aware of that because it's such a common and socially promoted misconception. There's been a lot of dedication among feminists to promoting that misconception.
Absolutely. All right, so that's the Emma Salkowitz story. We'll move on to the next one. This is probably a bit nicer. I think you'll like this one. Some great news. Okay, so this was submitted by Arweg, who is one of our contributors. A father's gratitude to the football fans who helped reunite him with his son. After becoming separated from his family and the streets of Paris before the start of Wales Euro 2016 knockout match against Northern Ireland, Tom Watkins, the son of David Watkins, eventually found a policeman to ask for help with finding his father and older brother amongst an enormous crowd of celebrating football fans. The policeman, who only spoke French, then elicited the help of the nearby fans themselves. One fan, Jason Pocock, from Ammanford, initially gave Tom his mobile phone to try and locate David, who was already searching for Tom through the nearby crowds in panic. When that didn't work, Jason was able to convince the boisterous fans to hush to near silence and drop to the ground in an attempt to make it easier for the worried father to be identified. The fans were eager to help out. In traditional football form, they began a chant, "Stand up! If you're his dad, stand up." And within a minute, David emerged from the back of the crowd and was reunited with his son. To see fans come together and do that was just wonderful, David said emotionally. The fans appeared equally happy with the outcome as they cheered, threw a beer into the air, and began singing a victory chant. And that's the story. Holy shit. I thought that footballers were toxic.
I got the feels. Stop it, Brian.
I know.
That's the thing. It hurts me so badly. Well, it hurts me when feminists talk shit about men because I see nothing but pure beauty in masculinity. It's so, so beautiful. I'm emotional. Shut up. All right. Moving on.
That's be emotional. That's awesome.
Story.
Let the manly tears flow, Anna. Let the manly
I know.
Tears
I can't help it. It's like, that's the thing, too, is that maybe it's because I'm exposed to men who are a little more on, like, the middle of the road or Italians or whatever the fuck, but, like...
You're Italians?
Yeah, because they cry. They cry at a drop of a hat, but they'll break
your
neck.
Oh, is that why I cry a lot? Oh, wow.
They're very passionate. But that's the thing. I see men who are passionate and alive and devoted and want things to work and want everybody to be friends and for everybody to have the best life they can. And that's what I see from men. Men are good. They're pure. And it just really hurts me. But that's right, as we were saying the other day, a lot of it has to do with the fact that many of these people, many of these feminists, have been hurt by men, and they ignore how they've been hurt by women, and they ignore how women spur on things that men do that are hurtful, such as slut-shaming, etc., and they just put all of the blame on the men without ever noticing their positive qualities, which are all around them. And it really, really breaks my heart. But I understand why they are like that. And I just really hope to infect as many people as possible with my viewpoint, where it's like, look, see these things. I just want to grab them by the collar and shake them. And it's like, look around you. You are so spoiled, and you have no idea how good you have it and how terrible what things you do to others. So, you know, imagine walking in a man's shoes and you think everything's going to be rosy and beautiful, but no, you have no idea. It's actually really fucking difficult to be a dude because nobody... Okay, this totally brings up something I wanted to share with you guys. Okay. I'm going to share it in the link right now. It's the I Love You Dad experiment, and it's from a popular YouTuber who did a Mother's Day video where he got a bit emotional, and then he decided to do the same thing for Father's Day to, like, talk about his dad, and he realized that in his family anyway, him and his dad don't say I love you to each other. It's kind of assumed, but, you know, they just don't do that. And so whenever... He has this app where all his fans can send in videos, and so he asked them to do I Love You Dad experiment, which is you randomly, you know, you're filming yourself or whatever, and you randomly go up to your dad and say I love you and see what their reaction is. And he had a bunch of his fans send that in through the app, and you guys can watch the video. You can zoom to the part where it begins. And it's heartbreaking almost. It made me cry watching it because... Men, the way men react to being told that they're loved is, it's so painfully obvious that they're not told enough, and that they, women just don't understand what it's like to not get any approval for your looks, for your contribution, for everybody to say that you're the bad guy when what you're doing is trying your hardest to provide. And I just can't handle it. And I think men desperately need to be loved, and they need to be told that they're loved, and they need to be touched and hugged and thanked and fucking appreciated. So, yeah. I think, and I'm really glad that he did this experiment, and because this could be a very important aspect of these people's lives. You know, they could look back on this random moment and be like, yeah, this father's asking, you love me, why? You know, I mean, how fucking sad is that? You know, that men are so not used to hearing, you look at that guy. I mean, he's not, they're not used to being loved and being told that they're loved. They're not used to getting any positive feedback at all whatsoever. And they're humans fucking too. Men are human. They have feelings, people. Mm-hmm. Why are we so protective of the female feelings and never consider that men have a soft inside too? Anyway, I'm going to be done now because this is a very, very, very important topic to me, and I get very emotional about it, so there we go.
Well, thank you, Anna. And I want to thank those footballers for coming together and helping that father and son find each other. I don't know how many people will normally go to a soccer game, but I'm guessing it's in the, you know, well over in the thousands, probably. So in order for them to all collectively, you know, help out and do that is, it is a testament to, you know, what men can do.
To masculinity.
And what we know about them. And what we know about them. You know, we guys know that. That's why they did it for each other, you know. We don't show it the same way that women do, but men do it in their actions. As evidenced by what we saw.
Well, that's the thing. I think women, I mean, of course, we're talking about outliers of, you know, let's say those women that are feminists, those who clearly have no empathy and very little care for others. A lot of times they, like, you know, they're armchair feminists. They don't do anything to help third world women. They don't do anything to do community outreach. They say things, but they don't show them. And that's the only way that anything matters. That's how you can be, how your words are put to the test, based on what you fucking do. So men prove day in and day out that they can cooperate, that they can love, that they are devoted, they love their children. That's the whole reason why we're talking about custody battles, because men want to raise their children, on average, most of them. And the ones that don't are children themselves. So sure, there are children among men and grown men and women. Let's ignore those, and then let's look at the bulk of normal humans. Men care. Men love. Men are devoted. They protect. They want things to be better. They create while women talk.
Mm-hmm. Does anyone else... That's something. Oh, Hannah, go ahead.
Yeah, I was going to say it's something I can expand on. Nobody's more dedicated. In the vast majority of cases, nobody's more dedicated to a child than that child's parents. And that's both parents. Men change their whole lives around their families, just the same way that mothers do, same way that women do. You know, dads change their career goals. They change how much work they're doing. They change whether or not, you know, they're going to live in a specific area. And that changes everything for them as well. They change their social lives. They change everything. Just because they had kids. The same way that moms do. And it's that degree of dedication is pretty much only seen in respect to children, you know, when you have children. But it gets ignored when men do it. And it's, you know, they're the ones that do it to the degree that they die younger. And they're the ones that do it to the degree that they're even willing to accept being expected to support two households, as long as that expectation does not extend beyond their capacity to earn. And they didn't spend 100 years fighting for there to be no child support. You know, if men didn't care, child support never would have happened. And yet it exists. And when there is a situation like this, when a child is endangered, that dad instinct in every man comes out. Even if he doesn't have kids, even if he doesn't want kids, it's very rare for a man to see a child in a situation like that, where they're in distress or in danger and not do something to help. And they do the same thing for women. Like, I've never had a flat tire in a public place without some guy coming along and asking if he could help. You know, and that's it may seem like a small thing to a lot of people, but it's a pain in the ass to change a flat tire. You know, and it's not that they're assuming I can't do it. Is that they're making sure I'm okay. And that's, you know, like Anna said, it's horrible that that's not valued. Mm-hmm. It's absolutely wrong that that's not valued.
Yeah, I agree with that. Does anybody else want to say anything about this football story? Is that how you say it? Football? This football story in...
Football or something.
Football.
Football without the American on the beginning of it.
Yes. Oh, great. He has the ball. He's kicked the ball. And somehow that is worthy of applause.
Oh, you mean soccer.
Hey.
Oh, we're talking about soccer, right?
Yeah, no, I was quote... Anna, I'm not actually criticizing it. I was quoting the IT crowd. It's not that. It's not actually how I feel.
That show's not very funny. Sorry. But, no, I'm not a fan of sports, but I am Russian, so European basically. And whenever football was on, I'd look at it and I go, "Wow, this is actually really fun. Let me watch." And it's understandable that Americans get bored because they're like, "It's been 2 hours and the score is 0-0. Yeah, but if you watch it, it's like a chess game with it's like chess parkour they do with their feet. It's fucking incredible. Anyway, I'm sorry. I'm done. Football's great. Shut up, Brett.
I didn't say it was bad.
It's because we get caught up in watching sports where the guys are trying to kill each other.
You should see this when we have a war. It's not just one country gets taken over, like Vietnam or some shit. Nah, with us, it's fucking 10 all by the end of the war.
All right, so we'll move on to the last story. It's a light one. So let me share screens. Stupid thing. Here we go. Okay, so Vox Media, always a quality of journalism. How a teen girl's mad Overwatch skills struck a major blow to sexism in gaming. No, this 17-year-old gamer girl did not cheat. She's just really one of the best Overwatch players on the planet.
Well, is she Asian or not?
She's Korean.
Well, duh.
Yeah.
That's why.
Gaming level Asian. But before we get into this, I do want to point out that Overwatch is like, what, maybe 2 months old at this point?
Yeah.
It's a little bit premature to say someone's the best player on the planet when people are still sort of getting into it. But
hold on. Are you trying to say that Vox Media is engaging in hyperbolic language to get clicks, potentially? Because that's what I'm hearing. If you could clear that up, maybe. I don't know.
There's also an open beta, so open-ish beta
before it was released. Therefore, she could have gotten an extra leg up
she could
on
have.
The competition.
She could have. Well, let's get into the story, and then we'll look at it for how they write it, but then we have to also look at what they're inserting that is difficult to determine.
Well, real quick, on that image, did she actually play Zarya, or Zarya is American?
Yes, Zarya is her character, because this drives
how
home
ironic.
The social justice-iness of it even further.
Right.
It's, you know, even more pertinent.
It's perfect.
Kind
so
of gorgeous-looking, pink-haired, you know, character made for Tumblr.
You know what's funny? There's actually a model, this girl from Australia.
Oh, yeah.
I forget.
I know. Yeah.
Stefania Ferrario.
Yeah.
Oh my God, she's amazing. And yes. She's fucking. There's some pictures of her. I didn't even think about this.
I can send it to you right now, actually.
Oh, do you have?
Oh yeah, I have. I'm on my Tumblr like a motherfucker. Yes, I have them on my porn Tumblr.
No, she's fucking rad. But yeah, people like found these and now they're going crazy over it. I was like, yeah, dude, she's fucking banging.
Oh yeah, no, I knew about Stefania for a long time. Mm-hmm. But like, let's be real though. Stefania is not a weightlifting broad. She is an immensely curvy broad.
Yeah, she is voluptuous.
And I'm calling her a broad because I'm a sexist.
yeah, that's you, Brian. All right.
So
is that using the broadest definition?
I am. okay, so let's get in the article. A 17-year-old professional esports player just crushed her enemies and delivered a blow to sexism in gaming, all in one live stream. Korean gamer.
She's even a professional. Oh my God.
Yeah. Korean gamer Giguri is currently ranked among the top 10 players in the world in Overwatch, a new team-based video game that's exploded popularity since it was officially released in May. As a predominant female gamer in a culture traditionally dominated by men, Giguri's success is both impressive and inspirational. Naturally, it's also the reason some of her rivals have accused her of cheating. In short, Giguri played a huge role in helping her Overwatch team, UW Artisan, rise to victory at a recent gaming tournament, so huge, in fact, that the opposing team, Dizziness, called foul. Two of its players, ETLA and Strobe, were so absolutely, totally, without a doubt sure that Giguri couldn't attain status as high as she did, they bet their entire career on their assertion that she must be cheating, agreeing to quit their jobs as if they turned out to be wrong. Pro tip, never risk your livelihood on the claim that someone is incompetent because of their gender. All right, now before we go continue, I want to speak to this real quick. At no point, there is no evidence at all anywhere that says that the reason why they accused her of cheating had to do with her being a girl. Vox is insinuating or implying that throughout this article. And I'm saying that because I have had people approach me about this article, and they said, did you hear about this story? Oh, man, you know, and then I was like, well, I'll look at it. And then I did, and I went back to them, and I said, you guys do realize that none of the people who are making these accusations said she can't be this good because vagina. They said, likely, she can't be this good because it looks inhuman. And if you watch the video, I can kind of see where they're coming from, but at the same time, you know, if there were men playing like that, they probably would have done it also.
Well, that's the question, right? Is it that what did this team have a very unprecedented comeback? Did something weird happen during the game? Or was it just, they beat us. Oh, look, they have a girl on their team. She cheated. Like, well, which one is it?
Well, that's just it. If that's what it was, if they said there's a girl on their team and that's why we know that she cheated, they would have quoted that. They would have said in an interview, they would have shown us some evidence of it. But
they would have jumped on that sexism.
Yeah, they would have jumped all over that if there was an opportunity. Like, if they could have gone to those guys and said, why do you think she's cheating? And the guy was like, because she's a girl.
Duh.
That would have been in the article, right? Yeah. Yeah. It's not, which means they didn't say that, or Vox is really bad at reporting, which it could be both of those things.
Right.
And, you know, there's no way of knowing that this is important because this is the way that, you know, these clickbaity websites that are trying to be mainstream twist just enough of the truth to fit what they already believe. Or what they think is going to drive clicks, which it may more likely be the latter than the former. So, okay, as a predominant female gamer in a culture traditionally dominated by men, Gaguri's success is both impressive and inspirational. I don't see why, because, you know, if you play games and you play them well, who gives a shit what your gender is? Apparently, well, Fox
the top, does. The top Hearthstone player is an Asian girl, and I'm pretty sure there's some, you know, League and other, well, maybe not League, but there's some other games that have women in their top, you know, 100, 50, 20, whatever. So I don't see why this is a thing.
Because feminism is in the gaps. I mean, that's why. When you don't
you
know,
mind the gap.
Must be sexism. Yep. In short, Gaguri played a huge role in helping her Overwatch team. Okay, I already read that bit. As one gaming site explained, some Overwatch players were surprised because Gaguri came out of nowhere to attain her ranking. Though the game was just released to the public a month ago, many professional gamers have been playing it since it was in beta. But while she may be newer to Overwatch than others, Gaguri has already competed in nearly 450 matches and boasts an incredible 80% win rate when playing as her preferred character, Zarya.
Okay, let me jump in there. Okay, they're presenting this as though she did this all by herself. She has an 80% win rate. Of course she has an 80% win rate, but who is she playing?
Sport.
This is very much a team game. Like,
and she's playing a tank who doesn't do much damage.
Good. You cannot do good at this game unless you are working with a team. And like the fact that they're
basically support you guys.
Yeah. No, the fact that they're totally ignoring this fact that this game you cannot be successful at it unless you work with a good team that is working together. This is just typical Vox bullshit. They're leaving out big chunks of information, and they obviously either because they're doing it on purpose or they're doing it because they're fucking ignorant. And I think it's more the latter than the former. I don't think they understand what the fuck they're talking about here, because they're leaving out some pretty pertinent information when
and
it comes to their
point.
Of explaining this.
When they're talking about her KDA as a tank and they're saying she's a killing machine, no, mm-hmm. She's a non-dying machine.
Yeah. Yeah, because if you have a healer, if you have a Mercy on you, or Zenyatta, or
Zarya herself, doesn't she have a shield?
Well, she does, but you still need to. You can still buff her, though. Like, if you've got somebody buffing you the entire time, you can deal tons of damage over an extended period.
She's basically heavy from Team Fortress.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Oh, exactly. Absolutely. So yeah, mm-hmm. This shows a gross misunderstanding of how this works, because they're not even they don't get it. They don't know what the fuck they're talking about. I mean, they're looking at numbers. It's like, oh my god, 80% win percentage. Oh, she's just the fucking Bobby Fischer of Overwatch. You know, it's like, come on.
Yeah, Bobby Fischer.
Fucking Christ,
well, clearly, they don't care though. They don't care about any of that, because otherwise, they wouldn't be making so many contradictions in their own claims.
Absolutely.
Like I said in our chat, they're simultaneously saying that she is unbelievably good, and that if you don't believe she's that good, it's because she's a girl. And then at the same time, she's a pro gamer, but she came out of nowhere.
Yeah.
Well, which is it? Is she a pro gamer, or did she come out of nowhere?
Well,
is she too good to be believed, or is not believing that she's that good because she's a girl?
Yeah, and
which
like Brian said, the game's only been out like a month and a half, 2 months maybe now, so everybody playing the game came out of nowhere technically, because the game is brand fucking new.
Since May.
Yes, I mean, maybe that's a nitpick, but it's just like, come on, this is just,
that's just it. Nobody could be said to be coming out of nowhere unless they were not involved in professional gaming prior to this.
Right.
You know, if she was not a professional, if she was just some, you know, Jill Schmo out of you know, BFE, nobody had ever heard of her before in any professional gaming circles, and boom, she does this. Well, then she came out of nowhere.
Well, okay. Yeah, but like they've said, she has a team. She is part of a team.
Yeah, maybe she rose to the top out of nowhere. Suddenly, her skills improved because she's playing a team game.
Yeah. Remember the Untouchables?
Maybe.
Part of a team.
you and I are the only two that are going to get that,
you
Brian,
get
probably.
That. Batter steps up to the plate. He is alone. What is that time for? Individual achievement.
Well, see, the question is, too, how does Overwatch calculate who the kill is awarded to? Because if we go back to Blizzard...
Well, it gives it across, it gives to multiple people.
Yeah, right, the individuals do get it. But here's the thing, though. To be honest, with Zarya, she's probably the most offensive of the tanks. So she has the capacity to kill lot of people. Mm-hmm. So, you know, compared to the other tanks... and it's mainly because of her ulti and her gun. It can do a lot of damage. So,
That's what I was going to say. Like, if you're good in League of Legends, that's one of the reasons I stopped playing it, is I was, like, obsessed with it for 3 to 4 years. But you compete with your own team for kills. So you have somebody who put in 99% of damage into somebody, and some asshole comes and hits, and they get awarded the kill, and then imbalance between characters grows as more of that happens, and you end up being on the bottom, your KDA sucks, and everybody's like, oh, look at that loser. While in Heroes of the Storm, which I'm obsessed with right now, Blizzard, thank you, you're totally turning me into a fangirl, and they share team kills.
Yeah.
And it is beautiful. It is wonderful. I'm like, when is League going to come around to actually sharing team kills, because it's a team sport? Competing with your own team is how you fucking lose. That's why League is so fucking toxic. So and also, you are not allowed to talk to the opposing team in Heroes of the Storm normal games, which I think is also contributing to not being toxic, because that's one of the things that people do. They start talking shit about their team to the opposite team. But anyway, Overwatch awards the kills.
Overwatch doesn't just award for kills. It awards for, depending on what your role is. So if you're a healer, it awards you for how much you heal. If you're a tank, it awards you for how much damage you're taking that other people are not. Across the board. So
they're calling her a killing machine.
And it splits up the kills, too. Like, you'll get, like, if you do 45% of the damage, you'll get 45 points for that, like, or whatever the number happens to be. So it ascribes value to what you have done.
Yes, depending on what you do.
They're trying to point out that she's a killing machine, which is like, well, my point is that she probably is a staying alive longer than other players machine, because she's a tank. And so the fact that she has high kill ratio, it also is a team effort. And they're, of course, ignoring that.
All right, so let me finish the article. Additionally, Gaguri's kill-death ratio of 6.31:1 is extremely high. Overwatch is a first-person shooter game, meaning the goal is to kill your enemies with giant guns while not letting them kill you. That's an oversimplification.
It is, because a lot of it has to do with capture the flag and hold the base and those team
forces.
Escort and all that kind of stuff.
It's not just kill them before they kill you. It's not that.
It's not a fun
Taking out an average of 6 targets for every time she dies puts her far ahead of the average kill ratio. Well, that's hard to say, because they haven't shown us what the other averages within her team or at her rank is. So we don't know that for sure. I mean, I have good days and bad days myself. So, you know. While playing Overwatch as a Zarya character, individual players self-report high KD ratios anywhere from 2-1 to 5-1. In other words, Gaguri is a killing machine. Let's exaggerate how awesome she is. So the sexism is that much harder when it hits. That's presumably why Etla and Strobe assumed she was cheating by somehow hacking the game. Meanwhile, other players wondered if she was increasing her firing accuracy by using moves deemed illegal in tournament setting. I don't know what moves deemed illegal is, but whatever.
Aimbots?
Oh, well, yeah, obviously, that would be cheating.
Yeah.
I just thought moves meant, like, something you're doing at your controller or computer whatever that
would be. Yeah, that's what I'm saying. These people don't know what the fuck they're talking about. Moves?
Yeah,
what is a move?
Yeah,
fuck is a move?
You fucking idiots. It's called an aimbot. Learn your shit, Vox.
To get a sense...
Call it a macro. I don't know. Like, fuck.
Yeah,
a move. What the... This isn't the PlayStation. Fucking... They have the move.
To get a sense of just how skilled Gaguri is... Watch the following video of her gameplay from the tournament that brought about Etla and Strobe's allegations. You can see that her targeting is jaw-droppingly precise. She hits dead center nearly every time. I'm not going to play the video because I don't want any issues, but, I mean, she does well, is all I can say.
You know what the thing is, though? Here's the thing. There's this thing. Oh, my God. Have you ever watched Counter-Strike players play a game?
Can't say that I have.
They're fucking ridiculous. These people are like, you know, the best way to describe it is like fucking like Rain Man, like fucking counting matches thrown on the floor, like how precise they are. Well,
that's
here's the
thing
though.
About Koreans.
There's, Well, here's the thing, though, is that there are actually programs, game programs that you can download that there's this one specifically for Counter-Strike where it actually pops up targets for like a millisecond, and you have to shoot them. And I watched this guy. I was curious what this was, but there was this guy on YouTube. I think it was Jack Frags actually. But he was showing this thing off, and he's sitting there, and these dots pop up, and he's like, ting, 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 and like he's nailing them. He's like, and he gets like an 85% accuracy on these things that are literally blipping up for like a fucking millisecond. It's fucking ridiculous.
Oh, absolutely.
And when people say stuff like this, they obviously don't know how intense some gamers are. I mean, there are people that are they're professional for a reason. They are fucking obsessed. They are so good. They have honed their skills. Their hand-eye-mouse coordination is so precise, it is to not be believed. Like this. I mean, it's like some people can just do that. It's like for mm-hmm. some people, these things just click naturally. Like, you know, like... For me, it was Rainbow Six Vegas. When that game came out, I was me and a bunch of friends had a competitive team, and we used to play tournaments and stuff and all this kind of bullshit. But for some people, it's Overwatch. For some people, it's CSGO. But for whatever reason, you know, these things click with people, and it's like, just because you think it's inhuman or unbelievable or whatever doesn't mean that it is. This is just how some people's brains operate. And they rise to the top because they are good.
Their brains, you know? to do that. Yeah. The thing about that is I actually experienced the same thing with League. I main Morgana, and her Q is a spell that is a capture spell, and it has a particular length and a particular speed. And after a while, I gotten so good at subconsciously predicting all of those and predicting where and how fast characters go that I can nail somebody through a wall, through a bush, and I fucking capture them like magic. Because it's just, I've been trained, my brain has been trained to do that. And on top of that, Koreans specifically have, especially with League, the way why they are the champions of gaming, and that's actually where everything started with the tournaments and having a lot of money as prizes. It all actually started in South Korea with StarCraft. And moving on from there, when they practice for League, the professional teams, they literally spend like 12 hours a day practicing not just the game, but they look for every little pathing corner, how each character takes which corner based on the box size, based on the size of their character model, and how that paths around the walls and through the bushes, and they actually look for exploits in particular map areas. So not only do they know their character and everybody else's character, they also know the map intimately because they spend all of their time doing this.
Yeah, because they're looking for things like where there's parts of, like you're saying, the exploits on the map, like where there's, like the hit detection is weird so that you can actually shoot through parts of the map or stuff mm-hmm. like that. Mm-hmm. So there's all these little things like that that people that aren't gamers and don't understand professional gaming and how games work don't really understand. They're like, oh god, this is unbelievable, it must be misogyny, you know,
yeah.
whatever.
Yeah.
You know, these stupid, uninformed arguments. So yeah.
I got a question, though. With all of these people making this accusation that the reason that anybody questioned her, whether she's doing this honestly or whether she was cheating, you know, that they did this because she was a girl, all of these people making this accusation, did any of this accusation come from her, or did she just take it in stride that, or take the fact that she was so good that somebody thought that she was using something automated, that she was actually cheating, that her skill level was so high that somebody mistook it for a cheat? Did she take that as a compliment?
Well, I'll get to the rest of the article. I think that she does say something about it, but maybe they're reading into what she does say, because there could be some things that were lost in translation since she's Korean. So I'll finish the article here. Etla and Strobe insisted that Yuguri simply couldn't be as good as she appeared to be, and according to the rumor mill, Strobe also allegedly threatened to show up at Yuguri's house with a knife if she was found to be lying. Of course, this is the rumor mill. Right. So the idea...
Why
but
are
of course
they reporting the rumor mill?
Because we have to send the message that gaming culture is violent and misogynistic, showing up to people's houses
boxes.
With knives.
Boxes. Isn't news media? They're not journalists.
Look,
they were the National Enquirer.
Yeah,
they were going to show up to her house because she was lying, not because she was a girl gamer, though.
Well, no, but that's no. but the narrative, and it's a rumor anyway. We don't know.
It's just funny that if they were going to talk about a rumor, it's kind of funny how they're showing men still be basically maintaining a bushido, which is if you're lying, I'm gonna fuck you up. But they're not being like horribly toxic, being like you're a girl gamer, you're too good, and you killed my fragile male ego. I'm gonna fuck you up.
Yeah.
Yeah, this is clearly not just go home gamer girl under any circumstances.
Yeah.
All right, so the rest of the article, which brings us back to how Gaguri ultimately put them in their place. After a complaint was filed and investigated, Gaguri was cleared of all charges. The manager of Gaguri's team even posted a transcript, link is in Korean, of a chat he had with tournament officials. But that wasn't enough to quell the controversy. So the Korean gaming site Inventory invited Gaguri to perform a live public demonstration of her skills. Take a look at the video from the hour-long live stream. The gaming gets started around 4:28, and things get really intense around 5:40. There's really no point to show. I mean, basically, she does really well, just like in the other video, where she hits, her targets, with dead accuracy. Of course, she's not alone. Her whole team is involved. And part of the reason why she's even getting kills is because everyone's doing their part, and she's a part of a well-oiled machine, but that's not important because it's all her. And the thing is, too, this is also something that I got to point out because language is important and these people are good at twisting these words. They said that wasn't enough to quell the controversy, but there's no reason to believe that because according to the next sentence, the Korean gaming site Inventory invited her to perform a live public demonstration. That didn't mean that they challenged her. They didn't say, you better come over here and prove it. It is likely that they said, hey, do you want to come over here and demonstrate why you're awesome? And then she was like, sure, could you get your tongue out of my asshole now? I mean, that's probably what it was really like. But see, the way that Vox is trying to paint it, it's as though they said, no, but you're a girl. There's no way you're good at this. There's no way.
I bet you make a movie about this. Someone's going to make a movie about this interpretation of this event. Lucy Liu is going to be the Anita Sarkeesian.
I was going to say it was going to star Scarlett Johansson, but
Oh, God. You're going to whitewash
Scarlett Johansson as Gaguri in. It's like she's the only actress in Hollywood. Or Jennifer Lawrence.
Oh, gosh.
Okay, so anyway.
Jennifer Lawrence as Gaguri.
Yes. She's going to do the Mockingjay thing where she kisses the finger.
Except it's going to be a peace sign,
Yeah. Yes. Oh, God. Oh, my gosh. Okay. They're going to really trump it up. The video shows the Gaguri's jittery on-screen targeting, one factor that contributed to the accusations made against her, is because it suggested she was using illegal moves, is actually a result of her unusual habit of quickly picking up the mouse while she turns and redirects her aim. This practice seems key to Gaguri's amazing ability to comprehend what's going on all over the map while she's fighting, even as she's simultaneously identifying the main point she needs to focus on. All right, so really quick about this. That is not a thing that she made up. That technique with the mouse is what people who play first-person shooters on the PC typically do.
I'm curious about that because I just started being of the PC master race. The console always felt much more comfortable to me because I grew up playing it.
So
yeah, because I want to get better at my PC gaming. So tell me about this mouse trick.
Yeah, I mean if you like point and click games, then PC is for you. So let me go to the bit where it starts. Let's skip over here, and you'll see that. So normally you'll see how quickly she moves the camera. Normally,
is she wearing a mask?
She might be. I don't know. I can't really tell.
Oh, no, that is.
In the lower corner, that's her.
Yeah, yeah.
Normally, I'm just pausing for the banana. I don't know if this is going to be a problem. So, normally when you're using an analog stick, the camera will only turn as fast as the stick will allow you to, right? But with the mouse, you have this ability to really make it move fast. So, and of course, all you got to do is keep the cursor in the middle, and you're good to go. Or like
so you don't lose your. Because my issue is whenever I turn, I completely lose where my crosshairs are.
Well, then you have your mouse settings too high, then probably.
Yeah.
Probably.
It says that
you need to turn off mouse acceleration also.
So I'll skip ahead a little bit.
See, I used to play Unreal Tournament, and I loved it, but I was, like, not nearly as good because of my... And my main problem is WASD. Like, I have a really hard time navigating with that, moving around, and yeah. But hopefully Overwatch will help me because I can't wait to get the game. It was amazing. I played the open beta. Well, I love Team Fortress.
Oh, good.
Yeah, I ended up playing the beta, so I was actually got to test
it
out.
I'm just pausing for the banana.
Yeah. What was I going to say? Oh, yeah, Team Fortress on the console. I had the orange box, so I was, it's like had three games in it. And Team Fortress is always like a favorite of mine, main pyro. Whenever I did Overwatch, I played Mei a little bit, but then Pharah, I think, is currently my favorite, with D.Va and Reinhardt behind that.
Yeah.
I prefer support roles as well, so I don't know.
So you can see that what she's doing. But, I mean, it's. I don't think this is... I think a lot of people who play FPSs professionally, they do the same thing. Because it allows you better
control.
So
what does it do? Yeah, the mouse... literally pick it off the mat for a second?
You pick it up... Like, when you're turning, you pick up the mouse, and then you quickly, you know, put it back down and move so that you can...
So your crosshair stays where you kept them.
Yeah, and then you can also... it gives you greater control... And it also allows you to quickly reposition where you're facing, what you're targeting. And in a way that controllers can't let you do, so much so that it basically means that experience on the controller versus the PC is going to be different, and they patch the game differently as a result of that.
Yeah, because the mouse is a one-to-one input, as far like whereas an analog is not.
Also depends on the mouse too, because as somebody was saying in chat, there trackball is amazing. We actually, you know, my daddy's a gamer, so that's how I actually got involved in gaming. Because I played some games in Russia, but then you know, not really, because it was a second world country that wasn't really, that wasn't as wealthy in terms of entertainment like that, and especially my family. Because they were academics, and that's why we left the Soviet, or post-Soviet specifically, Eastern Europe, because academics were not being paid anything, and like the gangster capitalists were being paid for everything. But the trackball is awesome. It is amazing. Thing is, though, you can't really find the best trackball Microsoft mouse anywhere, and we had one that actually broke, because it fell down way too many times, and there's no way to fix it, and then a replacement for it is literally $500 on Amazon. Like, Microsoft optical trackball that is very comfortable. The ball's right in the center. The mouse is amazing. Yeah. But I can't fix it, and I can't get another one because they're, like, ridiculously expensive. Microsoft stopped making them. And every other trackball, like Logitech and others, I've tried them, and they're just not nearly as good as Microsoft. So, I don't know. I might have to switch to trackball from my mouse in general to get better. But, anyway, I'm all about reading up on Giggery skills so that I can get better.
All right, so anyway, my point is what her technique that Vox is suggesting is like something that she, in a dark room by herself, before joining the tournament out of nowhere and yet being a professional, invented like some shit out of Rain Man. It's not actually something that she invented. It's just a way that a lot of the pros play. And Vox is acting like, oh, my God, I've never seen it. It's so unorthodox. How do you do that on Mario? Anyway, so, more importantly, though, the video shows that Giguri has fully earned her spot in the world rankings, no matter what many people in the male-dominated world of esports would like to believe, because she's a girl and we can't believe it. That's, what the fuck?
Yeah, Vox. Because no other girls fucking exist in gaming, you bigots.
Many people, this is a weasel word. We don't know how do you know that many people believe this, or don't believe it? In the aftermath, justice for Giguri has been attained. True to their word, Etla and Strove, the two gamers who bet their careers on her alleged incompetence and dishonesty, have reportedly quit the sport. Meanwhile, the follower count on Giguri's brand new Twitter account has shot up, and she's been bombarded with fan art depicting her playing as the pink-haired Zarya character. Her gaming handle, I'm not reading that, means frog in Korean, hence the many words that contain a pink-haired frog. Because the Pepe did not exist before she came along. This is another thing that she invented, apparently. The pink-haired frog is all her. God fucking damn it. I can't translate it, so I don't know what it says. But these are, like, the tweets that she's gotten. Now, of course, people might only... They may, like, be celebrating her because they just like her. And it may not be because she showed the patriarchy in gaming culture what's what, but rather they were just like, she's a good player. I like the way she plays Zarya. And no, they probably have a lot of other people that they follow too, and they probably send them artwork as well, but fuck those people, they're men.
But no, it's the it's obviously the patriarchy, Brian. It's obviously that. She is it to the man. It's obviously
it's the
that.
It's the patriarchy.
The patriarchy?
It's in gaming. It's got to be the patriarchy.
All right. But all this hubbub likely would have been avoided if Kaguri had been a man competing in what is generally considered to be a man's sport. So basically, if she was a man, none of this would have happened. Basically, I'm sorry.
I mean,
male gamers get accused of cheating and hacking, too. Yeah. Accusations go around all the time, right?
Yeah. But then that's when you fucking 1v1, scrub. 1v1.
Yeah. You know? Or but the thing, the difference is this. If a man is accused of accusations when he's playing a game and he proves them wrong, he doesn't get a giant article written to him on Vox about him on Vox magazine or Vox.com or whatever the fuck. Yeah. Because he's a man, fuck him.
Yep.
You know? So
there's nothing special about men that play games, but there's something special about a girl that plays games. So we have to separate them and elevate them as a special class. Mm-hmm. Like little fetish idols. We have to care for them and make sure they're tended like a bonsai tree.
I still say making it about gender is actually a deep insult to her. You know, if she made it about gender herself, she's insulting herself. And I got a personal story to go with this. Okay. When I was a kid, I joined 4-H because I wasn't allowed to do scouts because they had to go camping, and I didn't have the health to go camping. So I joined 4-H, and I couldn't do like the farming stuff that 4-Hers do, but they had a photography thing. And you basically have a project that you do during the year, and you take it to the county fair, and you get judged against other kids that have done the same type of project, and then somebody wins and goes to the state fair. And at 9 years old, my first year in 4-H, first years are required to do a photo story, not just a photograph. I don't know if it's still that way, but my photo story got picked to go to state. And I was competing against high school kids. You know, not just other 9 year olds. There was no age group for that. So usually kids my age didn't go to state. And there were, like, none of the other kids said anything. None of the other kids got, you know, hatey about it. But there were parents who felt like their kids should have gone to state that accused my father, who is a professional photographer, of taking the pictures for me. You know, and at first I was really embarrassed and in tears and everything over this because I knew I had taken those pictures. And I knew I had had a camera in my hands since I was 2 years old and that I had been training basically for this. I essentially was a professional photographer at heart and in knowledge in some ways by the time I was that young or that old. And my dad is the one that really came out and said, "You don't realize the compliment that they have given you. They mistook your work for the work of a professional photographer." And I had to think about that for a minute. And once I realized it, I stopped being embarrassed and, you know, about the accusations. And I was like, yeah, you know, let them have their sour grapes. I'm being accused of cheating because my work was so good, they can't tell the difference between my work and work that somebody has gotten paid to do. And at 9 years old, you know, so I was really proud after that I had made it, you know, that early, and I made it to state, you know, the next year and the year after, and I got the same thing out of people until I got to where I was above the median age or the middle age of the kids that were doing photography through 4-H. And every year, you know, we were able to show that I had taken the pictures. But it's
should have had your dad
this
take
is something
pictures
that she should have. But I mean, this is
You should have had pictures of your dad taking pictures of you taking the pictures.
That would have been hilarious. Yeah,
you could have started a whole series.
He had pictures of me taking the pictures, and that was actually what the proof was. But it would have been great to have mom take a picture of dad taking a picture of me taking my pictures for 4-H. because that would have made a great story. You know, I was working for the local newspaper before my last year in 4-H, so I was actually doing professional photography, and eventually I quit 4-H and quit being involved in those contests because they're really more amateur contests. Even though farm kids that are going to grow up to be professional farmers still compete with their livestock and everything. But this girl should have taken that road, really. She should have said, look at me, I'm so good. Everybody thought I was that what I was able to do on my own was an automated cheat.
Mm-hmm. She should have taken it that way. Let's see if we find out how she does take it. If they talk to her. I can't remember. Okay. Oh, no, she didn't actually... Well, here we go. Hold on. Okay, case in point. When two male pro gamers were recently accused of cheating at Overwatch, neither of them had to perform a live demonstration to prove their innocence. Actually, she didn't have to either. She was invited on, and she chose to go, and she showed. It probably, like, whether or not it had anything to do with her, the accusations is not known. Because Vox didn't tell us. They just assumed, they lumped all this together without actually saying, this is the direct result of this thing. They just said she was invited to do a live demonstration. And for all we know, it was just them saying, holy shit, this girl's awesome. Let's see it. And they're just twisting it. Instead of, you know, like it being them saying, you're not allowed to continue to compete unless this. And the people who are making accusations are not the same people who forced her to come on and demonstrate via an invitation. I didn't know invitations and force were the same, but apparently they are. So, whatever. All right, so here's a quote. Sometimes I feel like a woman can't be considered good without people believing there's some sort of sorcery going on. Now, this quote will make people think that that's what she said, but she did not say that. Because it immediately is followed by commented one observer on a Reddit thread discussing the situation. Okay! Some random person on Reddit has an opinion. Let's put it in our article because we have a narrative to push.
Right.
The fuck? Still, Overwatch's developer Blizzard has been keeping a careful watch, maybe an Overwatch, over the new game and its players, booting 1,500 Overwatch accounts for cheating at the beginning of June. Gaguri may be the first female pro Overwatch player to have to defend her reputation against the sallies of sexist critics. But with the game's burgeoning popularity and the scrutiny being applied to pro gamers, she may not be the last.
Oh.
It's got to be sexism.
She's a trailblazer.
She is. She is doing it in the land of Blizzard's fantasy world of Overwatch. And thank you for validating her fear. Important thing to add.
Brian, she is the new hero gamer girl for the age of 2016. For current year, she is the icon. They're gonna make little statues of her and sell it on the internet, and people are gonna buy it, and they're gonna take those profits from selling those little statues, and they're gonna fucking give it to feminism, and feminism is gonna cure everything.
So just bear in mind, guys, when you read an article like this, read it very carefully and look at how they frame it and look what they choose to omit or what questions there are still there. Be extremely careful because Vox would have you believe something that likely did not happen at all. I mean, at all. Like, there's actually no real evidence of anything. They're literally pulling shit from the rumor mill and Reddit comment threads to try to back their claims. What the fuck?
Yeah, it also looks like they're featuring some tweets, but once again, they don't even have a, not a reporter, but a correspondent who can translate. So
no, yeah, they have tweets, but no one's translating it.
What's the point of, not just these tweets, but lower, it looked like it said Gaguri to add Gaguri too. So I'm like, is that actually Gaguri's account? Yeah, right. Add Gaguri. Is that like actually her account? Is that a fan account? No. What are they saying? Fuck you, Vox.
And it's not like they don't have the tools for this, because Google Chrome will translate it for you, and then you could screen cap it and have the picture of it.
It'll translate crappily, but it'll at least give you a gist.
Yeah. It'll give you the tone of it in some respects, you know.
At least now we know who to credit the creation of the Pepe to. Was Overwatch and Gaguri. Who would have thought? Here, right. I thought the Pepe was old. But no, it came out this year. I mean, I'll have to go back and accuse anyone who's been using this incorrectly of plagiarism.
And sexism.
And sexism, because clearly Pepe is not
appropriating a female something. Something.
Scroll down a little bit, Brian, to the next image. Oh, is it that boy? Is that what that is? Minus the unicycle?
Maybe. And I'm wondering why they haven't done a dat boy yet. Somebody guys that's watching need to get on that.
Oh, God.
Do that shit. Yeah, no, the Pepe didn't exist, did not exist before this happened. There is no, because this was, like, the done for her. This is her thing.
Yeah.
Oh, all right. Well, anyway, I'm going to stop sharing now. So, I guess... I just want to say that I want to thank you guys for coming on. I got nothing else. Please.
Well, no, you do have something else.
I do have something else.
What do we have? Hold on. Where's the share screen thing? Screen share.
I was going to say, we could always talk more Ghostbusters.
Oh, God, please don't.
But it's so delicious. It's so delicious.
Where is my thing? I'm being retarded.
I've had enough sodium for one day, Scott.
But I don't know, man. Did you look at the
salt down? I did. It's a BuzzFeed article.
It's incredible, though. They even invoked Trump on it. I was like, wow, they did it. They managed to do it.
And their very last point is gleefully lay waste to these people's childhoods and dance through the male tears. I kid you not. That's the last thing they said.
It's amazing. We gotta do a show on this. Just on this article alone.
This is what we have.
Oh yeah, yeah.
Oh hey. Sure. Let's see. Well, I've shown this. I mean, I think I've talked about it. Yep.
I have those bookshelves too. That's my favorite photo.
This is Stefania Ferrario. She was, but there is something about her that I will throw in there that she. Be careful that there's nothing to.
Pretty sure not, but
these are all safe. But
yeah, they're all safe.
There was once because I knew about her for a while. I use her photos for art references, but she actually appeared in an article in the Huffington Post and the Guardian and Slate and other progressive websites because she was a plus size model with short hair and. Her whole, like, she was basically standing up for it, and she said that, you know, plus size, being called a plus size model is not empowering, and she was expressing discontent about it, and the article that wrote about her tried to make the implication that this was something that men do to women, and that because it's a standard that men have, and not like individual men, but I mean men as a collective, because we are a collective, right? But I just want to say that Stefania, as much as I like looking at you, you are wrong about that. If you want to challenge the notion that you are being called a plus-size model, if you have a problem with that, you need to fight against the mostly female fashion and fashion magazine industry.
It's specifically fashion industry, and it actually has nothing to do with male or female even at that point, because really what it's all about is the fact that the dresses that they make for runway are really, really, really expensive fabric, and so they want to use as little of it as possible per dress, and so that's why usually it's size 0 or 2 at most, and so all the models are made to fit that size because they're fucking cheapskates for making their dresses. The end.
Well, and the term plus size isn't something that was created by men. At least it wasn't created by men to discuss women in general. It comes out of clothing catalogs. It doesn't come out of... It's actually straight out of there. If you want to buy women's clothing and you look in catalogs to see what's available there, there are a set of sizes that are like the regular sizes. And they say plus size or they say women's. And every time a term for anything larger than average becomes politically incorrect... or women start getting butt hurt over it being used, they change it again.
Yeah, it used to be big and tall or large or right. round, and then it became plus. And it's like the George Carlin thing where he's talking about the shell shock, and now it's post-traumatic stress disorder.
Sorry, yeah.
So,
yeah. Concise. Well, to the point. Like they have terms like that for guys' clothing. Like big and tall is a term for guys' clothing. There's another one that they use. Like it's not stout. It's something stocky or something like that.
Husky.
Yeah. And for kids, like, you know, when my son was growing up, he had this habit of, like, he'd put on weight, and then he'd get, you know, several inches taller all at once, and we'd have to buy new pants 3 times or 4 times in a few months. And the first set of them would be stocky, and the last set of them would not because of that. You know, so this, and no, guys have never come out and be like, stocky is hurtful. Don't sell pants with the label stocky on them just because my belly is bigger than other guys' bellies. You know, no, it's only women that do that.
You know what, though? When I was a kid, because I went through the same kind of stuff, Hannah, and I used to actually get shit about that because I used to wear husky jeans.
That's
because
bullshit.
So, I mean, it's
well,
like,
hell,
it's like,
guys,
you know,
had to wear those too.
Yeah, it's like people want to, you know, people want to equate this kind of thing only with feminine things. It's like, oh, you know, women are, you know, they're traumatized or whatever. But when I was a fucking kid and people were making fun of me for wearing husky jeans, that fucking sucked. I mean,
well,
it's
don't
just
you understand? Like, yeah. Women have a gentler, softer heart, and they're just hurt more often. No, I mean, they're strong and
powerful.
Unless
we're skinny.
No, wait.
Unless we're skinny. Because, like, when I was in high school, I was 5'9" and 120 pounds, and I couldn't help it.
That's
and
me.
By God, I was not supposed to have same emotional response to being accused by my classmates of anorexia to the point where I couldn't go to the restroom after lunch without having somebody start a rumor that I had been in there vomiting. You know, I'm accused of being bulimic to support my accused anorexia. No, I wasn't supposed to react to that, but if, you know, somebody felt like they had been called fat, they could have a meltdown.
Oh, that's
and it was okay because their feelings were hurt.
Oh, that's a very American thing, because growing up in Eastern Europe, where everybody was walking everywhere, to the bus stop, to, you know, just walking places, because we didn't have cars, weren't as rich as America, and so everybody was, you know, to thinner, because we exercised up and down stairs all the time, and so that was never, ever an issue growing up. Nobody ever called me anything until I moved to America, and I started cosplaying, and they're like, oh, you can't fill out Lulu, and, you know, eat a burger, and grow some boobs, and I was like, really, people? Really? You're skinny shaming me in America, and then yet fat shaming is like the worst thing that you could ever do while I am naturally like this, while the other ones are eating their fucking sadness away. Are you fucking serious? Like, there's a mental, not disorder, but there's a need for improvement of the mental health on one and completely natural, healthy on the other, and yet I'm the one being shamed. Makes sense.
We need. Can you turn that off? It's
too
I'm
exciting.
Distracting.
I'm getting.
Yeah,
I'm
I was going to ask when I saw the back-to-back picture there. I was like, really, where can I get those bookshelves? That wasn't the shelves.
A part of me is becoming plus sized. So.
yeah, no, there's a female privilege. Then. We can get as. Excited what? About something as we want, and nobody will know.
It's a male, yeah. It's a,
no outward sign.
It's bad for guys. It's not fair because, you know, women basically don't show their attraction. Like, men can't help but show it. It's like, what bullshit is that? Talk about power inequality.
I know, it's unfair. It's really unfair. Anywho, oh, thank you,
we're
Scott.
Having this conversation, aren't we?
We need to go.
Yes, we are having this conversation.
This is the end. I want to thank Anna and Scott and Hannah and Mike for joining us on the show today. Join us next week. We'll have more news stories that will run the gamut of emotions in the same way that this one did, from the funny to the angering to the tear-jerking.
To the sexy.
To the jerking.
To the just plain jerking. And we'll see you guys... next time on the Polecat. Oh.